begrüße ganz herzlich unsere Gäste aus den verschiedenen Ländern des Westbalkans. Wir haben hier heute Abend eine ganz ausgezeichnete Runde von Spezialisten zum Thema Medien. Nicht Spezialisten, nicht nur in dem Sinne, dass sie sich als wissenschaftliche Experten und Expertinnen damit auseinandersetzen, sondern dass sie selber, viele von ihnen, zu den wichtigsten Trägern und Trägerinnen unabhängiger Medien in den verschiedenen Ländern zählen. Sie werden sie dann im Einzelnen kennenlernen. Aus den Gesprächen heute habe ich den Eindruck gewonnen, dass die Situation einigermaßen oder sogar sehr bedrohlich ist. Und zwar auf verschiedenen Ebenen bedrohlich. Bedrohlich tatsächlich für unabhängige Medien in der Region. Bedrohlich für Journalisten, Journalistinnen, die sich auseinandersetzen mit den Netzwerken von Politik, Wirtschaft, Verbrechen, die auch zum Teil physisch direkt bedroht sind, so wie man das eben in solchen Verhältnissen leider kennt. Abgesehen von der unmittelbaren Bedrohung für Medien steht diese Bedrohung aber für eine wesentlich größere Bedrohung, die, so sehe ich das auch nach den heutigen Gesprächen, die ganze Vorstellung einer europäischen Friedensordnung oder der Durchsetzung, der langsamen Durchsetzung einer europäischen Friedensordnung auf dem Westbalkan in Frage zu stellen scheint. Nämlich das sich Verfestigen autoritärer Regime, die zum Teil sehr gut darin sind, die von der Europäischen Union vorgegebenen Szenarien sozusagen als Imitation nachzuvollziehen und zu befriedigen, die aber zugleich sehr, sehr gut darin sind, ihre eigene Machtbasis auf nichtdemokratischem Wege zu befestigen und auszubauen. Und darin entsteht dann auch wieder eine Verbindung zu dem großen Thema im Osten unseres Kontinents, in Osteuropa, nämlich die Frage, welche Rollenmodelle auf dem Westbalkan heute eigentlich wichtiger und stärker sind. Ist es das Modell von Rechtsstaats-, Gewaltenteilung und mehr oder weniger liberalen Demokratien? Oder ist es doch eher ein Rollenmodell, das von Orban über Erdogan bis zu Putin reicht? Das ist sozusagen der Spannungsbogen, in dem sich unsere Veranstaltung heute Abend bewegt. Ich bin sehr froh, dass es so gut geklappt hat mit der Kooperation mit der Südosteuropa-Gesellschaft, deren Präsidenten Gernot Erler ich ganz herzlich begrüße, auch Herrn Brey und Tobias Flessenkemper, mit dem wir diese Veranstaltung gemeinsam vorbereitet haben. Das ist nicht unsere erste Kooperation, das machen wir ja schon öfters und wir machen das immer wieder gerne. Und last but not least auch ein herzlicher Dank an meine Kollegin Gudrun Fischer, die hier in Berlin das maßgeblich vorbereitet hat, und meine Kollegen Andreas Poltermann aus Belgrad und Mirella Gründer-Dicevic aus Sarajevo, die heute Abend auch hier sind. Und damit, bitteschön, Gernot.
Lieber Walter Kaufmann, lieber Herr Flessenkemper, verehrte Gäste aus den Westbalkanstaaten, es ist mir eine Ehre, Sie alle hier heute begrüßen zu dürfen, und ganz besonders freue ich mich über die Teilnahme unserer Gäste aus Südosteuropa. Ich bin sehr gespannt auf Ihre Erfahrungen, Anmerkungen und Kommentare zur Medienfreiheit in Ihren Ländern. Meine Damen und Herren, alle Staaten des westlichen Balkans haben sich für einen Weg in die Europäische Union entschieden. Und das ist ein langer und herausfordernder Weg. Dieser Weg der europäischen Integration bedeutet nicht einfach ein Abarbeiten formaler Kriterien, ein Erstellen zahlreicher Aktionspläne, die Verabschiedung von Gesetzen. Dieser Weg, wenn er erfolgreich gegangen wird, bedeutet vielmehr eine tiefgreifende und nachhaltige politische und gesellschaftliche Transformation der betreffenden Staaten. Und das Ziel dieser Transformation ist klar: die Stärkung von Demokratie, Freiheit, Rechtsstaatlichkeit und Wohlstand. Eine grundlegende Voraussetzung für eine funktionierende Demokratie ist die Einhaltung von Meinungs-, Rede- und Medienfreiheit. Es ist evident, eine freie Medienlandschaft ist unverzichtbar für einen demokratischen Meinungsbildungsprozess. Wir alle wissen, dass die Situation der Medien in den Staaten des westlichen Balkans keine einfache ist. Auch die Ursachen für diese Situation sind nicht einfach. Es gibt nicht etwa den allmächtigen staatlichen Zensor, der über das Ja oder Nein einer Veröffentlichung entscheidet. Die Situation ist komplexer. Zum Gesamtbild gehört die schwierige bis prekäre wirtschaftliche Situation vieler Medien, die sie anfällig machen für politische Einflussnahme. In diesem Zusammenhang problematisch ist die oft intransparente Eigentümerstruktur der Medienkonzerne und der Anzeigenmärkte. In manchen Ländern kommen zudem immer noch tätliche Angriffe auf Journalisten, du hast das eben erwähnt, und deren Eigentum vor. Eine untragbare Situation. In diesem Umfeld ist es für viele Journalisten und Verlage schwer, nicht der Gefahr der Selbstzensur zu erliegen. Zum Gesamtbild gehören aber auch die oft verbesserungsbedürftigen Standards der journalistischen Arbeit. Oft geht Gesinnung vor Solidität, geht die Verbreitung ungeprüfter Gerüchte vor gründlicher Recherche. Und zu den schlimmsten Auswüchsen gehören Verleumdungskampagnen gegen Personen des öffentlichen Lebens. Ich denke, wir sind uns einig, es gibt viel zu tun. In der Pflicht ist die Politik, sind die Regierungen und Parlamente, aber auch die Journalisten, Chefredakteure und Herausgeber selbst. Der Weg der gesellschaftlichen und politischen Transformation ist noch weit. Im Text der Einladung zu dieser Diskussionsveranstaltung habe ich gelesen, die EU sei angesichts der geänderten globalen Lage zu Abstrichen bei grundlegenden Werten wie Medienfreiheit bereit. Und da wird auf die geostrategische Konkurrenz mit Putins Russland verwiesen. Ich bekenne, dass ich diese Einschätzung so nicht teile. Lassen Sie mich in diesem Zusammenhang klar deutlich sagen, es wird ungeachtet aller derzeitigen weltpolitischen Turbulenzen, und an denen fehlt es ja nicht, in den EU-Beitrittsprozessen keine Rabatte geben. Nicht, was die Rechtsstaatlichkeit angeht, nicht, was die demokratische Regierungsführung betrifft, nicht, was die Grundrechte betrifft. Denn eines ist unbestritten, die EU ist und bleibt in allererster Hinsicht eine Wertegemeinschaft. Zum unverzichtbaren Fundament der EU gehört der Respekt vor den Grundfreiheiten und Bürgerrechten wie Medien- und Meinungsfreiheit. Ohne dieses Fundament kann es keine erfolgreichen Beitrittsprozesse, kann es kein erfolgreiches Europa geben. Deswegen setzt sich die Bundesregierung, setzt sich Deutschland gemeinsam mit seinen EU-Partnern konsequent für die Einhaltung der Konditionalitäten in den Beitrittsprozessen ein, auch und gerade gegenüber den Regierungen der Staaten, über die wir heute hier sprechen. Und dies sehen wir und unsere Partner vor Ort nicht als Einmischung, sondern als Unterstützung des von den Regierungen selbst angestrebten und von den Bürgerinnen und Bürgern erwarteten Transformationsprozessen. Meine Damen und Herren, daher werden wir uns auch im Rahmen des deutschen OSZE-Vorsitzes im Jahr 2016 für die Stärkung der Medienfreiheit im gesamten OSZE-Raum einsetzen. Ich bin mir sicher, dass uns die heutige Veranstaltung die Möglichkeit geben wird, diese von mir nur angerissenen Themen ausführlicher und tiefer zu besprechen. Und ich wünsche uns allen eine fruchtbare Diskussion darüber. Vielen Dank für die Aufmerksamkeit.
Guten Abend, meine Damen und Herren. Ich habe die Freude, hier das erste Panel zu leiten als Moderator. Und was wir uns überlegt haben für diese Veranstaltung, sind zwei Themenblöcke. Herr Kaufmann und Herr Erler haben sie ja schon anklingen lassen. Das eine ist, und das wollen wir hier bei diesem ersten Panel behandeln, vieles ist gleich in den Ländern Südosteuropas, was die Mediensituation angeht, ist aber manches auch anders. Dieses Panel soll sich etwas mehr auf diesen Aspekt, was ist anders und was ist speziell in den Ländern, konzentrieren. Deshalb haben wir mit den Panelisten vier verschiedene Länder hier repräsentiert, die uns jeweils zu Beginn ein kurzes Einführungsstatement, eine kleine Präsentation machen der Lage der Medien, wie Sie sie sehen, aus Ihrer Perspektive. Ich habe hier bei mir Herrn Agron Bayrami von Coaditore, ein Journalist aus Kosovo, Leila Bicacic von dem Zentrum für investigativen Journalismus aus Bosnien und Herzegowina, Željko Ivanović von Vijesti in Montenegro und Svetlana Lukic von Pečanik in Serbien. Wir werden einfach so in der Reihenfolge vorgehen mit diesem allgemeinen Statement zur Lage in diesen vier verschiedenen Ländern. Und wir würden dann anschließend eine kleine Fragerunde hier oben auf dem Podium führen, um dann für Fragen des Publikums zu öffnen. Agron.
Thank you, Tobias. Thank you for having us here, for organizing this event. I think it's important to discuss the media situation, especially in this moment of time in which the region has slowly disappeared from the radar of many policy makers, not only in Germany, but throughout the West, because of understandable reasons. While the situation is not better, in many regards, it's even worse. You said that you want us to speak about the different aspects that we do not share, about the things that are special to our countries when it comes to media situation. But I think that we have to touch upon the issues which are common, because I think most of the problems are joint. I will shortly just give you three views about the media situation in Kosovo, of which one is maybe particular for Kosovo only, and two others are probably very same with the other countries here. The first one is about what is the current situation with the freedom of media and freedom of the speech. I mean, this is the question that we are posing here. Is there a free media, or is there enough free speech? I think in case of Kosovo at least, the question should be put a little bit differently, because there is freedom of speech technically. The issue is what happens after you exercise that freedom of speech. Meaning, those media that are professional enough and courageous enough to address the most sensitive issues, such as war crimes, and investigate the government corruption, as well as the links between the organized crime and political parties and the state officials, those media face the heavy consequences of practicing this freedom of speech and professional reporting, among which the most frequent are threats and attacks against individual journalists, but there is also political and economic pressure against media. On the other hand, freedom of speech is not even affordable for most of media in Kosovo. It's a commodity that can be exercised only by the most devoted, because it means giving up on government money as a source of income. It also means facing political and economic pressures and being even called the worst names, from liar to traitor, in cases when you report things like war crimes. It also means standing up to the strongest and the biggest single political, social, and business factor in the country, and that is the government. Because those who chose investigative reporting, professional standards, and free media inevitably find themselves that they need to confront this government, which is the biggest employer, is the biggest investor, as well as the richest entity, I shall say, in the country. In this sort of environment, you could see that most media are not willing to uphold basic professional standards. Many have fallen under the control of political entities and of various interest groups. And most notably, which I think is a shared experience in all the countries of the region, is that the government parties control the public broadcaster, in Kosovo's case, the RTK, and use it openly as a propaganda tool. We have even had recently a case of a conflict within the public broadcaster in which 12 editors have written a public letter explaining that their superiors have demanded for particular programming to be transmitted and particular leaders to be put in the newscast, while particular parties to be eliminated from the newscasts. This is so the current situation, as I see it, of the state of the freedom of media. The other aspect that I want to talk about, and which is shared, I think, is the undemocratic, so to say, surrounding in which we exist and work. You see, Kosovo, in my view, is not a functional democracy. Its institutions are properly constructed only on paper. In reality, political influence has corrupted most of the state institutions, which are supposed to be independent, from judiciary to regulatory bodies. Corruption is high, rule of law is selective, and independent press is constantly under attack. Government and parties behave as if whatever they do is their internal affair. It's sort of Cosa Nostra, if I may say, in which media, as well as the public, are excluded fully. There's no transparency and no accountability. Parties themselves are undemocratic entities. Parties' elections even are manipulated. The party soldiers which follow the leader are the ones who rise through the ranks, while the critics are eliminated from the party. In this way, the party conventions are scripted reality shows where leaders are regularly elected without counter candidates through acclamation. The most recent case was elections which were held in LDK, which is the governing party now, the party of the Prime Minister, Mr. Mustafa, last May, just 2 weeks ago. Journalists were expelled from the convention. There was only one candidate for the president of the party. 99% of the delegates voted for him. And the only one delegate who didn't vote for Mr. Mustafa is now under pressure to resign from the party. For most politicians, EU, and this I have mentioned throughout the day in our meetings, EU is a tool, not the goal. Politics is not a way to positively affect the reality, but a shortcut to becoming rich and powerful. For these reasons and many more, critical media that are not ready to blindly accept whatever we are told are the enemy of the system. So is the free speech the enemy. And the third, and this is to conclude, factor which I think is different from all the rest countries of the region in Kosovo is the international presence. So specific for Kosovo is the fact that we have a huge international presence which was not only diplomatic but also had held executive powers. And even today so, with the EULEX mission being the one mission which holds executive powers as well. Unfortunately, the huge international involvement and presence in Kosovo has not resulted in better media environment. The international community, including European Union in particular, and Western democracy in general, have failed in building a democratic Kosovo. This is, and I'm really sorry to say, because this is a statement which might be contradicted by many, but this is the feeling that many people get there. Of course, the main burden of this failure falls upon the shoulders of Kosovars themselves. But a huge part of the blame is also shared by the West, by supporting the corrupt and criminalized political elite. For the sake of maintaining stability, international community has sacrificed the very democratic principles it so wholeheartedly advertises. Furthermore, in recent times, Western officials have engaged themselves in attacks and pressures against media. We have the case of EULEX against Coeditore, which is the newspaper that I edit. After we exposed a corruption scandal within ULEX ranks, our journalists were faced with pressures and threats by the ULEX officials. And these sort of examples only lessen the trust and the belief among not only the journalists but the public as well, that something can be changed even with the help of the international community. And I would be very much willing to continue discussion later because I hope we will have some questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Agron, and thanks for keeping the time. The only thing you forgot to mention is to say a couple of words about Coaditore and your role in there.
Well, okay. I thought that you presented me well enough. I'm editor-in-chief of Coaditore newspaper, which is the first privately owned newspaper in Kosovo. We work since 1997, and we love to think of ourselves as independent liberal newspaper, which does not depend on any political party or government for support.
Thank you. So moving on from a newspaper perspective in Kosovo, with one of the particular features of international presence, we move on to the case of Bosnia and Herzegovina, where we have Leyla Bicakcic, who is working for the Center for Investigative Journalism. And maybe, Leyla, you could start by explaining quickly what this center is working on.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me to participate in this interesting event. It's always a pleasure to be a part of the discussion on the media freedoms in Balkans, because the overall definition of the media freedoms is something that we are not quite familiar with, not in Western standards. I'm coming from the Center for Investigative Reporting. It's a news agency, essentially, working particularly on investigative reporting and introducing the investigative reporting as a novelty in the media scene of Bosnia and Herzegovina. We were founded in 2004, and ever since we are run by by local people. I'm a director, we have a local editor, and local reporters doing investigative reporting in accordance with the international standards, which again is a novelty. We are donor-funded organization, so we do not share much of the problems related to the financial pressure and financial difficulties that other media in the region are facing. So we are sort of a different one, and it's hard to talk about certain issues related to media from my shoes because, again, I'm not sharing most of the issues. However, going back to the case of Bosnia and listening to my colleague from Kosovo, I can tell that the situation in Bosnia is pretty much the same as in Kosovo. I will not be repeating myself in explaining the same structure as in Kosovo, because Kosovo and Bosnia are being two experiments of international community. We, same as Kosovo, have a huge international presence for last 20 plus years. We have been harmonized over and over with the international codes, standards, conventions. We have been a sort of a playground for many different approaches to be exercised in Bosnia, and some of the models used in Bosnia have never been replicated to Kosovo. Thank God they haven't. So, but obviously in Kosovo it doesn't work. I will not be repeating the same issues. I will be talking about some specifics of Bosnian journalism. Because of the administrative structure in Bosnia and the division between the two entities, ethnic division that is still very present in Bosnia and Herzegovina, unfortunately we have a situation that we have a media pluralism in a number of publications or number of outlets, media outlets present in Bosnia. We are currently having, and I have the statistics, fortunately, 44 TV stations, 140 radio stations, 10 private daily newspapers, 4 news agencies, 100 magazines, and 80 online portals. In a country of 3.7 million people living, a country that is living on the edge of poverty, this is too much. The pluralism in a number of outlets does not really contribute to the pluralism in media reporting. It doesn't contribute to the standards. It doesn't contribute to really to anything. It's just a concentration of media outlets. One of the problems that journalists in Bosnia and Herzegovina are facing is the media ownership that is definitely not transparent, and media is being used as a way of extended political influence over the public in general, over the citizens, because you can see that media outlets are really conveying the message of the political parties one way or another, and it's very easy to follow up or to determine which political party is influencing which media outlet in Bosnia and Herzegovina, which is a shame. Another thing is advertising industry. Advertising industry in a again, very small country with a very poor population is again politically affiliated, and that is another way of influencing the media field in Bosnia or reporters directly through the advertising industry, where the journalists are forced to think about what they are writing about or what topics are they covering if they do not want to engage in their position. Journalist salaries are extremely low, particularly compared to the standards of Western Europe. The protection, the union, the association of journalists are extremely poor, non-effective, and they are again ethnically divided. So we are talking about a very poor system of protection of journalists, individual journalists, and a very complex system of pressure that is affiliated with the political parties that is actually transponded through the media ownership directly to the journalist. It's very hard to work in such an environment, particularly again in a country that is not even in a position to negotiate the accession into the EU. We are not even a candidate country compared to some other countries in the region. I will have to now criticize the journalists themselves. They have declined their standards in reporting. They are not reporting in a way that they should. They are sinking into easy topics because it's easier to cover the jet set. It's easier to cover the political agenda as it is than to talk about than to go into difficult topics and really investigate. The investigative reporting again is not widely present in Bosnia as it is not in the region as well. We are no different probably there. We have to talk about the self-censorship as another problem in Bosnian media, because we are very much aware that self-censorship is becoming the main standard in reporting. Reporters are not even considering going into slightly difficult topics simply because it is difficult to do that. They are not sure that they would be protected on one side, and they do not want to go into a danger of reporting on something that might potentially affect their position in the future. When it comes to the legal framework for the media scene, which is again another difference between Bosnia and other countries in the region, is that we are relatively good. We have a relatively good legal framework related to the media laws. The libel, for example, which is an extremely difficult issue in other countries in the region, have been taken out of the criminal code of Bosnia and Herzegovina. So we are talking about a very liberal legal framework that has been harmonized with the EU. EU standards and laws. Unfortunately, the implementation of those laws is not always smooth, and it's not even guaranteed in some cases. Threats to journalists, illegal surveillance, phone tapping are practice. I will just briefly, before I stop here, I will just briefly give you the statistics. The Bosnia and Herzegovina, based on the recent Freedom of Press Index that was published just recently, has been positioned on the 66th position out of 180 countries, which is good. Compared to the region, we are second best. Croatia is just above us. But that is good result, that's for sure. But when we look at the abuse index, which is a component of this Press Freedom Index, we are in the neighborhood of Sierra Leone, Haiti, and Algeria. We have an index of 30.91, which is the second worst in the region. Serbia is the worst, unfortunately. So that gives you the whole variety of the approaches, that the journalists are not free to do their job. And on the other side, they are not seeking that freedom as effectively as they should. So I will stop right there.
Thank you, Leila. Some similarities, obviously, some peculiarities in terms of the legal framework. Und wir machen weiter mit Montenegro. Jelko Ivanic, Montenegro ist jetzt ein Beitrittsland, ein Beitrittskandidat, also schon etwas in einer anderen Situation. Ich weiß, er hat auch ein paar Präsentationsslides vorbereitet, die ich glaube...
I have some presentation, but it's
wollen Sie die
a little
benutzen?
Wider and I will go... Can we? No.
Können die Präsentation gemacht werden? Ja, dann kriegen Sie die. Genau, nun ein paar eine Einführung mit den Slides.
I'm Jelko Ivanovic from VST, the daily newspaper and portal. We are the biggest daily newspaper and portal. We have 80,000 unique visitors per day. Total population in Montenegro is 650,000. Penetration for internet is less than 60%, what means that everybody who has normal connection with internet and over Wi-Fi, minimum one time per day visit our portal. What means that we are credible and people believe in our journalism and believe in our reporting and we are happy because of that. And it is results of 25 years of our work, because we started together with our prime minister, who is still prime minister, and he started with wars and war crimes. It is first slide, 19th, with Milosevic, and we started with first weekly magazine Monitor, who was anti-war, who was promoted human rights and fighted against hate speech and crimes and everything what we had in the 90s in ex-Yugoslavia. But in that time, thanks to support from, of course, European Union, European countries, United States, we built a very strong civil society, NGOs, independent media, who play in that dictatorship times, who played very important role to protect society and to lead society in some peaceful situation, which we has taken in the end of 90s, when we finished with Milosevic era, when God finished job for Croatia with Tuđman era. Unfortunately, we were not happy in Montenegro, and as I said, we still have the same prime minister who, fortunately, in the end of 90s, changed his policy and moved from Serbian nationalism to pro-European and pro-Western policy, and start to be that partner in the region for European countries and especially for the United States. But unfortunately, on the other side, it is second. In nowadays, we have completely what is a little paradox. We have a completely different situation with media. I could say we have just few still alive independent media from 90s, and majority of other already died, or they were privatized by some tycoons, local tycoons, or some international corporation who cares much more about profit than about standards and democracy. Now have what means these weak democratic alternatives, strong monopolies, shaking civil society, and almost ruined independent media. And in this context, I like to quote a professor from Belgrade University, Snežana Milivojević, who said that media who survived dictatorship in 90s, they couldn't survive democracy. And it is that type of democracy which we called very often democratura, what is combination between democracy and dictatorship. It is that soft type of dictatorship. And few weeks ago, we published now a newspaper, very good article. I think that two professors from United States, they published a book about this new type of soft dictators in the world, from Chavez, not this who died. There is new Chavez in Latin America, Putin in Russia, Orban in Hungary, Djukanovic in Montenegro, this guy in Indonesia, I don't know his name, but it is new type of dictatorship where people on power use monopolies, use money, use intelligence service, use control of institution to destroy any alternative, to destroy independent media, to destroy civil society, and to build just their monopoles and uncontrolled power. Because that we could say for media in all the region that we are lost in transition, and there are a lot of examples in Bosnia, and Leila knows it, that Dani and Oslobođenje now, who play very important role in wartime Bosnia, now they are part of some local tycoon group. The oldest Macedonian private television was cancelled by Mr. Gruevski, prime minister, a few years ago. In Croatia situation is same with independent media. Feral Tribune died. We have inside of European Union in countries, we have problems with freedom of media. Hungary, or few years ago in Italy, in Berlusconi time. Turkey, maybe you know that more than 60 journalists are still in jail in Turkey. And it is a situation which is very discouraging, and what is problem that what Mr. Erler said about the importance of this succession process, and of course it is the most important thing for all this society, and I'm sure for 10 years that all this society will be very different, maybe deeply change inside, not just government, and just politician and party, that society should be changed. I think that the example of Croatia is very good example, where we have seen that during that accession process, all country change, and after 8 or 10 years, we get one very, I think I could say, normal European country with normal media environment, where we have just three TV station with national frequency, and just three or four daily newspaper in market, which is 20 times bigger than Montenegro, for example. And in Montenegro, we have seven national TV station, and we have four daily newspaper. And it is way how people who are not Democrat, who are dictators, how control media and how destroy media, because Serbia, Svetlana knows it very well. Serbia in Milosevic's time was a world recorder with number of newspaper, magazines, radio station, TV station, but it is way how to destroy market and to don't allow to any media to survive in that market, because when you don't have a financial independence, you can't speak about independent media and about professional media. And how to survive and how to take the time when we will be normal society, normal country, I don't have answer. And European Union is in one very delicate situation, how to play between stability and standards, how to support stability and support politicians who are guarantee for stability for short time, and how to keep standards, because with them it's very difficult to expect that they will accept that standards, because that standards means stop with their monopoly, stop with their power, and stop with their governance. And because that we on the field we have very unfair competition, and what Leila said about Bosnia, especially what Agron, who is columnist of VST from Kosovo, and now our correspondent, what he explained about situation in Kosovo, it is same situation everywhere in Montenegro too, and through this, all these channels, advertising, control business, physical attacks, court cases, government use all the, that instruments to destroy independent media, and in especially in small market like Montenegro is, because total advertising budget is 10 million euro per year. In Croatia it is almost 200 million, and you could imagine that if we have Mr. Obama for president in Montenegro, you should manage business and media in the best way to survive and to have some business. And you could imagine after all these streets harassment which we passed in last 6-7 years, that how we can speak, and it is really phenomenon. And I can't say how we still alive, because you know there is that cynical situation when you speak with Europeans, European governments, bureaucrats from Brussels. They said, you know, we can't. We understand you. We know that Djukanovic is connected with mafia. That Djukanovic is corrupted, but we can't support media, because media are outlets. You are on the market. But I said to them, but okay, I agree. For 15 years, we never ask for any support, but we don't have market. Can you obtain us market and free competition market? How we can speak about market and surviving of, on market when he has, for example, two media, two daily newspaper, which he finances with millions per year? Because officially owners of that media, you could imagine, is some tycoon from Malaysia and some tycoon from Greece. And you could imagine their interest to build democratic society in Montenegro and to build the investigative reporting and professional media. Of course, they have interest on the business side, because they rented hotels, they have other businesses, and they combine it with our prime minister. He gave them a lot of advantages in business area. They give him two daily newspaper who destroyed market and who don't allow us to survive in normal circumstances. Similar situation is on TV market, and generally, you know, we have this is last report of Reporters Without Borders. Montenegro is 114 position in index of freedom of media after Nigeria and Zambia. And we are just better compared with Macedonia, because I think Macedonia is 117. And but it is same kind of you know leaders. It is same kind of demokratura everywhere. And we have Djukanovic in Montenegro, but we have copy of Djukanovic in Macedonia, copy of Djukanovic in Kosovo, Tači, copy Vučić in Serbia, in Bosnia. And you know, Europe should be patient and should continue with this negotiation access. But if Europe continue to be blind about problems for civil society and independent media, they will die. And I think that for 5 years, nobody will want to write in and to do. To be a journalist in Montenegro, for example, or to be a civil society activist, because when they see how we are under the streets, everybody said, you know, this younger generation, I visited university, and they said, you are crazy. We don't want to pass that what you passed. We don't want to be in this situation to live 24 hours under police protection or something like that. And it is some problems. I understand the position for European Union is not simple, for Germany is not simple, but somebody should take some leadership. And today I said another problem is that position between this European Union, between these two giants, United States and Russia, who cares much more about own interest and about some own policy than about standards and democratic values, what is base of European tradition and culture. Thank you.
Thank you, Jelko, as well for the information provided on the slides. We conclude this introductory round with Svetlana from Vyacheslav, and maybe you can also say a couple of words about the media outlet you are representing.
Okay. Najpre, izvinite što ću pričati na našem srpsko-hrvatsko-bosansko-crnogorskom, ali ja sam i Srbim i pravim probleme stalno, pa onda. Tako i ovog puta. Ja sam izbačena sa državne televizije početkom 90. godina kao neprijatelj i izdajnik srpski. To je u velikoj meri zasluga sadašnjeg premijera koji je tada pravio liste neprijatelja. Tada je bio ministar informisanja i bio je desna ruka Slobodanu Miloševiću, tako da je naše prijateljstvo datira već unazad 25 godina. Potom sam godinama radila na B92, koji je bio simbol slobodnog novinarstva, a pre nekoliko godina smo moja drugarica i koleginica Svetlana i ja napustili, jer smo videli da će to prerasti u treći razredan mediji, koji je sada zaista sramota za novinarstvo. I odlučili smo da krenemo od nule. Trenutno nas dve doslovno i dvoje, troje saradnika imamo web sajt koji ima dnevnu posetu oko 25.000 ljudi. Imamo dnevnu televizijsku i radijsku emisiju koju emituje 15 radiotelevizijskih stanica u Srbiji, Crnoj Gori, Kosovu i Bosni i Hercegovini. Znači da to za dve žene, još koje gledaju 50. godinu s druge strane, sa pogrešne, nije mali zalogaj da to opstane. Prvi put, eto, posle toliko godina rada i sa Miloševićem i sa Koštunicom i sa svim, ozbiljno razmišljamo da je vreme da, što bi rekli fudbaleri, okačimo kopačke o klin. Jer je jednostavno sadašnja vlast našla dosta dobar način da satre ljude, da satre medije. I naravno, kada govorimo o medijima, cilj i Đukanovića i Vučića ili bilo koga drugog nije da uništi medije zato što inače mrzi medije, nego zbog toga što je koristi medije da bi se obračunao sa svakim političkim protivnikom. Dakle, to je instrument koji oni imaju u rukama. Milošević je tim instrumentom započeo rat, to je veoma moćan instrument, a recimo sadašnja vlast to koristi kao instrument da uništi opoziciju, da kriminalizuje opoziciju, da uništi glas nezavisnih intelektualaca, da jednostavno može nesmetano da laže svakoga dana o bitnim i o nebitnim stvarima. Kad kažem, ne da tumači pogrešno, nego da laže. Ono što je evidentno, mi smo se malo takmičili ko je gori u medijskoj poziciji, i tu je negde foto finish, ne zna se ko je gori, jel? Međutim, mi imamo najveći broj medija, mi imamo 1400 medija, tako kažu, i naravno da je to organizovani haos. Namerno je pravljen 1400 medija da vi više ne znate šta da radite. Naravno da ne zna se ko je vlasnik medije. Pazite, mi imamo najveću novinsku kuću u Srbiji koja se zove Politika. Jednim delom je vlasnik država. Drugi vlasnik, veoma moćan, je jedno poštansko sanduče u Moskvi. Ne zna se uopšte ko sedi na toj adresi. Osnivački kapital tog nekoga ko sedi u Moskvi je bio, valjda, ja mislim, oko 10.000 evra. I sada Evropska unija podržava medijske zakone koji su doneti u Srbiji, podržava povlačenje, odnosno privatizaciju medija. Ko normalan će kupiti Politiku ako ne zna ko je vlasnik 50% kapitala? Dakle, mi u Srbiji imamo posla sa klasičnom cenzurom iz doba socijalizma, klasičnom kontrolom sadržaja, Imamo naravno, kao što su oni novi diktatori, tako imaju nove načine i metode da jednostavno onemogućavaju ljude da rade. Reći ću vam samo recimo na primjeru Peščanika. Mi imamo dve stvari zbog kojih oni doživljavaju nervne slomove. Prvo, jedna je što smo mi finansijski nezavisni i finansirani smo od strane pre svega skandinavskih donatora, nemačkih, pre svega Heinrich Bela. Znači, nezavisno finansijski od njih i to je već veliki problem za njih. Druga stvar je što se ne plašimo. I onda, pošto ne znaju šta bi sa nama, onda je naš sajt sistematski obaran i rušen u posljednje 3-4 godine, ali, dve godine. Ali pazite, doživio je havariju u momentu kada smo mi objavili tekst u kome je aktuelni ministar policije, najbliži saradnik premijera Vučića, dokazano plagirao svoju doktorsku disertaciju. Kada smo sledeće nedelje objavili tekst gde je dokazano da je gradonačelnik Beograda, leva ruka premijera Vučića, plagirao doktorat. Kada smo posle nekoliko dana objavili tekst u kome je najveći privatni univerzitet, da je njegov vlasnik lažirao da uopšte ima bilo kakav doktorat. A na tom univerzitetu predaje pola ministara, a druga polovina je tamo doktorirala. Dakle, na osnovu jedne teme koja nije strašna tako za srpske uslove, jel? Ne radi se o ubistvima, ne radi se o velikim novcu, to je bilo dovoljno da jednostavno mi budemo pod permanentnim napadima od tada pa do sada. Kako se policija u tom momentu ponaša? To je ta igra koju oni imaju. Vi prijavite u policiju, odete tamo, oni vas tretiraju više kao optužen nego kao nekog koja je došla da se žali. I što se uradi? Ne dogodi se apsolutno ništa za godinu dana. Dakle, ni jednu informaciju nemate od tužilaštva, od policije šta se događalo. Čak neće ni da simuliraju da nešto rade. Zašto je to tako? Ima dve mogućnosti. Jedna je da smo mi davali izjavu u jednoj kancelariji policiji, a da iz druge kancelarije neko rušio sajt Peščanika, recimo. Da je direktno vlast u ovoj ili onoj meri obarala, recimo, naš sajt. Druga mogućnost je, a to je da oni ništa ne čineći ohrabruju da svako to može da uradi, a da zna da neće biti kažnjen. Naravno da nije najvažnija stvar ni Peščanik ni bilo šta drugo. Govorimo o načinu ponašanja. Dakle, da ogroman broj ljudi shvata u Srbiji, ako bijem ženu i ako ubijem ženu, a imamo seriju ubistava žena, ništa mi se neće desiti. Ako budem koristio klasični govor mržnje u parlamentu, ništa mi se neće desiti. Ako budem povodom fudbalske utakmice i drona, jel tako, potegao ceo govor mržnje prema albanskom narodu, ništa se neće desiti. Naprotiv, svi će pljeskati zato što je Vučić otišao i razgovarao s Edi Ramom u Tirani. Jer ove iz Evrope izgleda zanima samo to, ovo kao ne znaju šta se tu desilo. A mehanizam ceo je pokrenut preko medije koje koriste ta ista vlast koja navodno stabilizuje region. Neću dalje da dužim, samo ću vam reći na jednom primjeru, odnosno sada nešto što je, dakle, mi smo kao država doživjeli strahovit pad, znači trend je važan u slobodi medija, i to u godini kada smo hvaljeni iz Evrope, kada smo doneli set medijskih zakona. Za 15 dana treba da se privatizuje skoro 80 medija. Državna agencija Tanjug, najveće novine kao što su Novosti, Politika i serija i lokalnih medija koji su bitni. Šta je u Srbiji normalno? Da se za kupca prijavi jedan od najbližih saradnika imenom i prezimenom Aleksandra Vučića. On će kupiti taj medij. Dakle, navodno ga država će, navodno država neće kontrolisati taj medij jer ga neće finansirati, a najbliži saradnici predsednika vlade kupuju te iste medije. Naš predsednik, naš ministar vojske je imao jednu televiziju. U poslednje dve godine kupio još dve televizije. Zvanično. Doduše nije on, nego njegova žena i njegov sin. Mi imamo, dakle, ljude iz političkog života čije mame, tate, sestre, uglavnom žene, su vlasnici televizija. Ceo mehanizam je razrađen, dakle, da nije bitno pitanje vlasništva medija uopšte. Nije problem to. Problem je kako se ti mediji finansiraju. Finansirajući tako što je napravljen ceo mehanizam da vi oprostite dug kad treba da oprostite, da date kredit kad hoćete da date nekome kredit. Jer pazite, mi imamo recimo ovako, mi imamo najveći, imamo monstruoznu televiziju Pink koja pokriva ceo region. To je sada reality show našeg predsednika vlade. On, samo što go se ne skine, ne počne da igra na televiziji Pink. Zašto? Zato što oni duguju ogroman novac. I on za porez. I ako kaže jednog časa predsednik vlade plati porez, on je mrtav čovjek kao medijski magnat. Ovako, za uzrat ima potpuno paralelni javni servis. Dakle, njemu ne treba da kontroliše javni servis, mada i to radi za svaki slučaj, nego je napravio od privatne televizije napravio partijsku televiziju. Inače, on sklon. Dakle, on je pravio paravojne formacije za vreme rata i on stalno pravi paradržavu. Dakle, kad su poplave, mi ne angažujemo Crveni krst, nego angažujemo vojsku. Ako, dakle, on ne stvara normalnu policiju, normalnu vojsku, nego stvara stalno paralelne institucije, ja se bojim, i time ću da završim, da se sve dešava tako da smo mi, i to mislim mnogo naših saradnika, mnogo naših autora koje ja smatram najpametnim ljudima u Srbiji, a to je da on sa vlasti otići neće mirnim putem. Da smo mi, što smo imali od demokratskih izbora, imali smo, i da smo mi kao mediji, jedan mali deo civilnog sektora, ćemo braniti elementarno, vratit ćemo se na 2000. godinu kada ćemo se boriti za elementarno demokratsko pravo da slobodno biramo i da vlast se predaje mirnim putem. Vi ste čuli za slučaj ombudsmana. Pazite, imate jednog čoveka, zaštitnika građana, koga su optužili za ubistvo. To je uradio predsednik vlade i njegovi najbliži saradnici. Znači, ako mu smeta, on će ga optužiti jednostavno za ubistvo. To su stvari od koje se zaista nisu dešavale jako, jako dugo u Srbiji, tako da smo mi u velikom strahu od toga šta će se desiti, pri čemu, naravno, treba jednostavno sve to preživjeti. Ja mislim da to što je ostalo od civilnog sektora i što je ostalo od medija, bukvalno su u pitanju meseci kada će i to nestati sa kao potencijalne snage koje će moći da se odupru diktaturi pod jedan, ili koja će moći da konstruktivno doprinesu da Srbija bude iole pristojnija zemlja koja će zaslužiti da se otvori poglavlje 23 ili 24. Ovako će možda dobiti kao poklon otvaranje poglavlja, ali to će biti jako, jako loša poruka jer će on smatrati da može da radi šta god hoće unutar zemlje, jer će reći evo ja sam vam donao poglavlja, dakle sve u najboljem redu, mi nastavljamo da se bavimo politikom kao i do sada. I ja bih apelovala nekada, pošto se ne razumemo politiku, da političari, ako ne znaju šta da kažu, neka ćute. Gospodin Han je na celu medijsku situaciju u Srbiji, koja je katastrofalna, rekao dajte mi dokaze da postoji cenzura u Srbiji. Ja posle se nešto izvinjavao, tako da je bolje nekada da se manje govori, ako već neće da se kaže ono što se misli, jer je jednostavno premijer Vučić tu rečenicu ponavljao danima. I rekao je šta vi hoćete, vi koji se zalažete za Evropu, kada je vaš čovek rekao da nema dokaza da u Srbiji postoji cenzura.
Ako ja samo mogu da dodam jednu rečenicu na ovo posljednje što je Svetlana rekla, a što je, da kažem, pogotovo za evropsku javnost ovdje važno, da sve te, da kažem, svi ti lokalni lideri koji kontrolišu novac, koji kontrolišu biznis, koji su među najbogatijima političarima ili najbogatiji političari u Evropi, slične stvari, oni sve više u posljednje vrijeme koriste ove lobističke grupe po Evropi gdje animiraju i evropske parlamentarce i čak i evropske neke ministri iz evropskih zemalja i zemalja Evropske unije, koji se, ovo što kaže Svetlana, javljaju kao u suštini njihovi propagatori. Tako da mi u Crnoj Gori, recimo, kad se desi nešto dobro ili loše vezano za rad vlade, odmah znamo da će neki Jelko Kacin iz Slovenije, slovenački parlamentarac, da se javi i da brani Đukanovića, da će neki Charles Tannock, britanski parlamentarac, isto to da uradi, da će Miroslav Lajčak, koji je ministar slovački za inostrane poslove, čak mislim potpredsjednik vlade, da će i on da se javi i onda će sva ova propaganda na naslovnoj strani tih novina ili udarnom terminu javnog servisa ili Pink televizije da citiraju i da kažu javnosti, da pošalju poruku, pogledajte ove iz nezavisnih medija ili civilnog sektora, to su ludaci, oni su, oni imaju nešto lično protiv Đukanovića, jer vidite da ugledni članovi Evropskog parlamenta kažu da je sve to u redu i da tu nema nikakvi problem. Tako da je to, kažem, još jedan novi moment koji se dešava, a gdje ponekad evropski predstavnici, zvaničnici, pogotovo diplomate koje rade na terenu, izgledaju kao taoci politika lokalnih lidera. Kao da se boje njih, kao da stalno traže neki balans, takozvani balans u kome se u stvari sakrivaju činjenice, u kome strada istina i u kome se šalju neke poruke koje nisu ohrabrujuće ni za slobodu govora, ni za demokratiju, ni za slobodu izbora i slične stvari.
Ja, vielen Dank für diese einführenden Statements und Beschreibungen der Situation, die ja wirklich sehr beeindruckend war. Das bringt ein bisschen mein Konzept durcheinander hinsichtlich meiner Fragen. Allerdings möchte ich zwei Fragen ans Podium stellen, bevor ich dann, bereiten Sie sich langsam vor, bevor ich dann natürlich auch die Fragen aus dem Publikum dazu einlade. Die erste Frage ist wirklich dieser Komplex, der jetzt auch etwas anklang. Wie geht Europa damit um? Und ich weiß, dass ihr alle heute Morgen oder heute Mittag verschiedene Treffen gehabt habt im Auswärtigen Amt, im Kanzleramt und auch im Deutschen Bundestag. Meine erste Frage an euch, was nehmt ihr überhaupt mit? Was haben die euch gesagt zu eurer Situationsbeschreibung? Was ist der Eindruck, den ihr gewonnen habt? Wie ernst man die Lage der Medien in den Ländern, in euren Ländern, aber auch in den anderen Ländern, Mazedonien und Albanien, also die verschiedenen Vertreter, die dabei waren, wie ernst nimmt man die Lage der Medien in diesen Ländern, in den Gesprächen, die geführt worden sind, in den Institutionen hier in Deutschland? Also das schließt so ein bisschen an den Punkt, den Jelko gemacht hat und auch Svetlana. Und die zweite Frage, die ich vorbereitet hatte, ist eine etwas allgemeinere. Die Klage über die wirtschaftliche Voraussetzung von Medienarbeit ist ja nichts, was nur typisch ist für Südosteuropa. Die letzten 20 Jahre haben überall einen Zusammenbruch des Anzeigenmarktes gesehen. Sie haben überall gesehen, dass die Digitalisierung vorangeschritten ist. Sie haben gesehen, dass das Medienkonsumverhalten anders ist. Und nicht nur in Südosteuropa ist die Qualität auf der Strecke geblieben, sondern ja auch in vielen Mitgliedstaaten der Europäischen Union und darüber hinaus. Die Anzeigenmärkte sind sicherlich etwas sehr Spezielles für Südosteuropa. Die Kontrolle über staatliche Unternehmen oder in staatlichem Besitz befindliche Unternehmen, die kleinen, fragmentierten Anzeigenmärkte kontrollieren. Hier die Frage, gibt es einen Weg daraus? Sind die Strategien der Digitalisierung, Viesti, Pečanik, Birn, ich denke auch Coaditore hat digitale Medien gemacht, sind die Strategien der Digitalisierung eine Möglichkeit, daraus zu kommen oder nicht? Also meine zwei Fragen zur Eröffnung ans Panel. Was ist der Eindruck, den ihr gewonnen habt von der deutschen Vision oder der deutschen politischen und Regierungsvision der Situation der Medien? Und zweitens, gibt es Strategien, wie Medienarbeit unabhängig gemacht werden kann? Ich schlage vor, wir fangen mit Leyla an und gehen dann in umgekehrter Reihenfolge über Agron, Svetlana zu Jelko. Und dann bitte Sie.
One correction though, I'm not from Bern, I'm from Zinn. But then again, it's the same country. The understanding of I might sound a little bit odd to the group. Understanding of the today's meeting, the approach of the people that we have talked to today is pretty much understood to me, at least. We cannot expect that the international community, that the EU is going to do a major job in our countries. That needs to come from inside the country. That's one thing. The accession to the EU is not mandatory. It's an option. And it needs to be dealt with from inside the country. We had when I was talking about the standards of the media and free speech, I said that we are talking about a declining trend within the society, within the journalists themselves. They are accepting the rules of the game. They are not fighting for their rights. They are not supporting themselves, because when we have attacks to the reporters inside the country, very few would actually support. We had a major case at the late December when one of the most influential portals have published the story on the, they actually published the audio tape of a prime minister of Republika Srpska buying two parliamentary representatives. She's basically negotiating them to approach to their party. Portal just published the audio tape, and at the eve of New Year, police raided the office of the portal looking for the tape. There was really no political discussion among the political leaders whether that was really necessary or whether that is a violation of reporters' right or right to sources, right to this and that. No, nobody was even talking about it, and even journalists from the country did not really support the reporters from this portal openly and widely. They were sort of, okay, yeah, that's really bad, but then again, what can you do? That's the environment. So they are not really supporting themselves. And in such an environment, we are expecting others to deal with us. Bosnia and Herzegovina is particularly difficult in that sense, because we have this trend. For 20 years, we are dependent on the international aid, on international presence, and we are basically waiting for somebody from outside to pressure our politicians to do their job, which should be quite opposite in the context of democratic processes. The problem is that citizens do not really recognize their role in, and nobody is explaining that to them. And that's where the media are failing. They are not really educating the citizens of what the role of citizens should be in a democratic society. We are still suffering from post-socialism approach, where citizens should be silenced and just follow the leader. And that's what the politicians are abusing in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And it's more complicated with Bosnia because of the ethnical division and administrative structure and other things. The second question was... strategies. Well, it's very hard to deal with the strategies, because again, I can talk about Bosnia. Bosnia has too many strategies and a very poor implementation of those.
I mean, what are your strategies as media?
That yes, I think that we failed as a media scene in Bosnia and Herzegovina. We failed in this run with the market economy. I don't think we are recognizing the trends that are present in the media, not only in the Balkans, but generally globally. We are not using the opportunities. We are not using the IT technologies as we should. We are not appreciating the technology in a way to advance our work, but pretty much trying to use the old methods, the old approach, the old tradition in the media, and not trying to find our space in the market. What are we? How many publications have actually tried data journalism, for example? Not many, at least not in Bosnia. How many TV stations have published something that is different? They're pretty much using the same scheme of the program. How they are appealing to the public. That's not going to work, because the viewers, the readers, the audience is looking for something else. They want to be attracted by the content in any form or shape. We are looking at the global trends of not really devoting too much time to looking for information. People want it quick. People want it in a form that is easy to digest. And that's something that media, in my opinion, have actually failed to contribute.
Yes, Tobias. I think even coming here, I was aware that we are not going to tell to anybody something that they didn't know. And generally, I think there are no secrets about what is going on. It's clear in each of the country all the difficulties that media face and other difficulties with state building and democracy and so on are very obvious. I think that especially in Kosovo, the huge international presence makes it impossible for something to happen without that being known. The problem is about the priority. How much is freedom of media a priority for European Union or for the Western countries, which have invested so much in the region as general, in Kosovo in particular? And not only media freedom, it's also about the fact that media freedom is part of a system of freedoms and values which eventually should lead us into becoming a country which merits European Union membership. Merits. This is important for me. Not to be given something because there is a need for stability or there is a need for, I don't know, to keep some process going on. But to transform a society so that it merits, that it becomes truly European, and then it won't matter whether you are formally a member of European Union once you become European in values. So media freedom and the way how media are treated, the way how media actually play the role within the society is about this. It's not about whether we get more share in the market. It's not about, you know, I used to say, if you would want to, and now I'm slowly moving to the second question again, if you want to become rich, you open a gasoline station, you don't open a newspaper. So the point is, in our societies, initially media were opened by people who believed the transformation of a society towards a democratic liberal one is possible. In the recent years, the politicians have understood that they can use this instrument and kill the idea of that sort of transformation and create their own propaganda tools. So even the media which are under government control, they are not there to generate money and income. So in that sort of a competition, we cannot speak about free market. It's not the field is not leveled for everybody. So if we would want to have a normal situation in which, yeah, we are going to think about what strategy will make me more competitive, I would need to be in a competition with equals. You cannot compete with a government which owns the budget. And I'm saying owns because they spend it the way they like. And I think this is the point. What we thought, or at least what I thought we could raise as an issue to debate here, is not whether the German politicians and diplomats or other know what is going on, because we know that they know, but is whether we can find a way to raise the debate and to bring it into the forefront in our societies, but also within European Union as a whole, and Germany as very respected and very powerful, I will have to say, country from EU, which is seen in the region, especially in Kosovo, as the factor when it comes to EU countries. Whether we can raise the debate on a different level, in which it is not negotiated that media freedoms are going to be a priority maybe after a couple of years when we deal with dialogue or when we deal with some other issues. That postponing the issue of debating the level of media freedom and other freedoms is actually sacrificing the level of democracy as a whole, which at the end of the day is going to bring us to the question whether we really want to build democratic states in the region or not. And this is the point that I think we try to elaborate, because constantly all of us, I think, not because we talked beforehand, but because we reflected the perception that we all have, we were constantly saying and complaining, I would have to say, that international community in general, including Germany as part of EU, is too willing to sacrifice things like media freedoms for the sake of stability. And where does this leads lead us? This is, you know, the question that we are posing here.
Svetlana, quickly on the two questions, and please start to prepare. Maybe you can indicate as well if you want to take the floor. So the two questions really is, what's your impression? What are you they are taking home?
Okay.
Second one, what could be strategies?
Ja sam potrošila sve svoje strategije, nema više ni jednu. Biti nezavistan kod nas, ja mislim da je jedina mogućnost do sada bila da mi da se finansijski nezavisimo od države, odnosno u svim njenim oblicima, od državnih institucija i firmi. Ako nas budu napustili strani donatori, to malo što imamo, mi imamo samo jednu mogućnost, još koja nam je ostala i verovatno ću nju morati vrlo brzo da upotrebimo, a to je da zovemo tu zajednicu za koju mi mislimo da smo napravili od nekoliko desetine hiljada ljudi da nam pomogne finansijski. To, jer nama je trećina publike, jesu emigracija koja živi u Kanadi, u Nemačkoj i tako dalje. Oni imaju tu kulturu pomaganja i ako to ne uspe, onda mi jednostavno ne možemo da preživimo. Druga stvar je da govori se stalno o slobodnom tržištu. Dakle, po zakonu je državna radiotelevizija dužna da 10% svog programa daje nezavisnoj produkciji. Pomisao da Peščanik sa svojom nezavisnom produkcijom dobije, je li tako, prostor na državnoj televiziji i da eventualno može da naplati svoj proizvod, je ravna tome da ja odem u paralelni svemir. Ja? To je prosto nemoguće. Prema tome, mi kad govorimo o slobodnom tržištu, problem je u tome što nekad, evo recimo da ću vam primjer, jedna nemačka firma, ako hoće Volkswagen da se reklamira u Srbiji, ja pitam, dobro, što ne biste došli kod nas da se reklamirate, jer naša publika su upravo ljudi koji su viši srednji sloj i u Srbiji. To su vaši kupci. Ali ne, on radi sa marketinškom agencijom koja njemu može da da prostor na državnoj televiziji na Pink, a marketinška agencija je, najbolje rečeno, bliska sadašnje vlasti. Tako da nas ni strani firme potpuno zaobilaze, jer mi nemamo nikakav pristup ni toj vrsti fondova. Dakle, a što se tiče samih utisaka, ja ne razumem se u politiku, sve manje se razumem u politiku. Ja mislim da je ovo što se desilo sa Ukrajinom, da ovaj hladni rat je od naših predsednika ili šefova vlade, traži jednu stvar, da se opredele za Evropsku uniju, da se svrstaju na tu stranu i da će sve ostalo žmuriti sada, dokle god da traje ukrajinska kriza. Pa će se jednog dana vratiti na teme kao što su demokratija, ljudska prava i tako dalje. Ja sa svojom koleginicom se delimično slažem i delimično se ne slažem. Ja mislim da, i naravno, mi smo najodgovorniji zašto imamo takvu vlast. I mi trpimo te posledice. Mi imamo takvo stanovništvo koje je glasalo za rat i koje je glasalo za ratne zločinice. I šta se to drugo i očekuje? Dakle, ako postoje mehanizmi, a očigledno postoje, zato postoji politika, da se na nekoga izvrši pritisak, očigledno da Nemačka kao i Evropska unija finansiraju nešto u Srbiji, neka pogledaju malo koga finansiraju. Neka pogledaju malo šta postoji još tamo, već, a ne da rade utabanim stazama i da pomažu državu, jer prosto to nije upotrebljivo, prosto moraće, ja mislim, da energije, ljudskih resursa i finansija da preusmere na ono što mogu biti sada začeci buduće demokratske države. Jer ovo sada će jednog dana biti resetovano sve i vraćeno nazad.
I think that my colleagues explain everything and maybe we should allow
I have, the audience yes, to... Very good, Jelko. I have a gentleman in the second row and then there's a lady who is just exiting the room. And then this gentleman here, maybe the gentleman in the second row. Können Sie sich bitte kurz vorstellen? Und ich glaube, wir machen ein laufendes Mikrofon. Das Mikrofon läuft hier in der zweiten Reihe. Der Herr da vorne. Genau. Könnten Sie sich vielleicht kurz vorstellen, damit wir wissen, mit wem wir reden?
Ja, mein Name ist Tomislav Masic. Ich promoviere an der Uni Oxford zum Thema konspirative Kooperation zwischen Medien, Staatsanwaltschaften und Politikern in Kroatien. Und meine Frage dreht sich um das Thema bezahlte Blogger, korrupte Journalisten. Das ist ja ein Thema, was jetzt nicht nur auf den Westbalkan beschränkt ist, was ja auch bekannt ist. Das Haus sogar, glaube ich, in Moskau, wo die von Putin bezahlten Blogger im Prinzip das Internet unterwandern. Das ist ein Massenphänomen in China. Der Guardian hat, glaube ich, neulich geschrieben, dass die NSA soziale Netzwerke auch hackt im großen Stil, um da quasi die Meinung zu beeinflussen. In Kroatien ist es so, dass es einige bezahlte, korrupte Journalisten gibt, die zum Teil sehr einflussreich sind, die auch für Geheimdienstfraktionen gearbeitet haben und immer noch geachtet, einige politische Optionen quasi hoch oder runter schreiben. Ich würde die Frage jetzt eigentlich gerne alle stellen, weil es natürlich tatsächlich nicht reicht. Würde ich gerne die Frau Lukic fragen, wie das in Serbien aussieht. Ist das ein Massenphänomen, korrupte Journalisten? Gibt es da einige bekannte Namen, die Sie vielleicht auch kennen? Und ja, also wie sieht die Situation in Serbien aus? Dankeschön.
Danke, eine Frage an Frau Lukic. Die Dame in der vierten Reihe, wenn ich richtig zähle, hier in der Mitte. Wir sammeln drei Fragen.
Hello, my name is Natalia Miletic. I'm a free journalist from Serbia. I actually don't really have a question. I wanted to comment on something that Mr. Erler said, and I'm very sorry that he left, because he mentioned that next year when Germany takes the presidency of OSCE, then they're going to push for more press freedoms in the East, which is a statement that I find a little bit irritating, especially when it comes to this region and these countries that we're now talking about, because we all know what kind of political influence Germany has in these countries. And I don't see any reason why they shouldn't start pushing for more of these freedoms right away. And I mean, the cases that Svetlana Lukic mentioned, where this was, for me at least as a journalist, like a wake-up call, because when this severe censorship of Vučić's government started, it was exactly at the time when we had the floods and then these affairs related to plagiarism. And Svetlana knows we were knocking on many doors in Germany, you know, to get some kind of a reaction here, someone to say, hey, you guys, you know, this is going too far. Nothing happened. The only one, the only organization that supported us was Reporters Without Borders. They were the only one that came forward and sent some kind of statement, like the state or all other institutions were silent, which is... yeah, really kind of sad.
I translate this into a question. So why not pushing for media freedom now? And the gentleman, der Herr in der zweiten Reihe hier vorne links. Und dann machen wir die, dann machen wir eine zweite Runde.
Also ich bin Faris Kalavic und was mich eigentlich nur irritiert hatte, dass Sie offensichtlich eine gute Finanzierung von den Journalisten von Ausland sehen und gleichzeitig eine schlechte Finanzierung aus dem Staat, eigenem Staat. Meinen Sie, dass die fremde Finanzierung etwas besser wäre, beziehungsweise sind Sie dann nicht doch korrupt, aber von draußen? Was bedeutet, und noch eine Frage dazu, wie sehen Sie sich als Journalist, Ihre Verantwortung für eine Stabilität und eine Bildung von Demokratie in eigenen Staaten? Beziehungsweise, weil Demokratie bedeutet auch, ich meine, über Korruption oder über Unfreiheit der Medien sollte man diskutieren, aber auch, ich glaube, in Deutschland ist das nicht gerade hochgestellt, aber gut. Und jetzt, dass man das als Vorbildfunktion, also ist nicht wirklich gegeben, würde ich sagen. Aber gut, das ist meine Meinung. Vielleicht sind die.
Vielen Dank. Also eine Frage zur Finanzierung an alle. Dann würde ich, also eine Frage war an Frau Lukic. Na, wir machen eine zweite Runde, Jelko. Erstmal Frau Lukic und dann die anderen, die zu den anderen beiden Fragen etwas sagen wollen, bitte.
Moje omiljeno pitanje o finansiranju. Pogrešno ste razumeli, dakle, mi smo finansirani od nekoliko stranih donatora i to je sa toliko novca da imamo za elementarne stvari, dakle, da iznajmimo server i da možemo tehničko osoblje da malo platimo. Tako da nikom ne bi poželjela da radi pod tim okolnostima i sa tim novcem. Drugo, meni niko nikada u 25 godina od stranih donatora nije me pitao šta si tamo napisala, šta si tamo uradila, napiši ovo, ne napiši ono. Ja smatram da su oni nas pomagali, tako sam to jedino razumela i tako bih jedino ikada uzela novac, da se naši interesi poklapaju. Dakle, da ovo bude jedna normalna zemlja koliko može da bude, da bude normalno demokratska koliko može da bude, da se ratni zločinci kazne ako mogu da se kazne i dakle postoji jedan zajednički neki valjda sistem vrednosti, neki zajednički imenitelj zbog kojih su oni to sada radili. Očigledno da mnogi sada smatraju da to ne treba i zbog toga on nam više neće pomagati finansijski ili je toga sve manje. Dakle, ja bih i od države, ali tako da mogu da apliciram u ministarstvo financije ili bilo gde da apliciram, međutim, znam pouzdano iz mnogo razloga da je direktno su uslovljavani ljudi ako želiš da dobiješ novac, šta treba da pišeš određenom ministru. To je za mene kao novinara sva razlika ovog sveta. Uopšte me ne zanima da li je Srbin ili je Nemac tog časa. Jer ja imam neke vrednosti koje su civilizacijske, koje su mnogi ljudi u mojoj zemlji prekršili, oni moraju da plate za to. Načelnik generalštaba je, ne može da bude načelnik generalštaba, on mora da ide na sud, da odgovara za ratne zločine, počinjene na Kosovu, to je moj stav. Dakle, to je što se tiče finansiranja, jer ja slušam od mog oca 30 godina da sam ja strani plaćenik. Jedna stvar, druga stvar, ovi ste rekli, da, vladajuća stranka se hvalila da ima 500 ljudskih botova, armiju od 500 ljudi koja svakodnevno truje internet i komentarima i to oni više ne kriju, pošto su oni dovoljno primitivne svesti, oni počinju time da se hvale i da znaju da koriste kompjutere, to je veliki civilizacijski dostignuće. Tako da mi na našem sajtu nismo demokratični, mi uopšte nemamo komentare. Jer u Srbiji ta vrsta otvorenosti samo znači da ste izloženi spinovanju i to nije realna vođa nikakve diskusije i zbog toga mi i druga stvar, ne možete o svakoj stvari da vodite diskusiju. Postoji nešto što je zločin i nešto što nije zločin. Postoji nešto što su civilizacijske vrednosti oko kojih nema rasprave. E, u Srbiji, i ne samo u Srbiji, ljudi stalno hoće da raspravljaju o tome. E, to neće moći, makar ne na Peščaniku.
Ja. Leila wollte noch, und Agron noch kurz zu den ersten Fragen, und dann hatte ich noch hier zwei Fragen für die letzte Runde.
When it comes to being funded by the international donors, we are talking about the democratic principles used with distribution of the grants, which is what Svetlana just said, something that our governments do not have. The funding distributed through different channels within the Bosnian government on different levels are not associated with any tendering procedure. There are no qualification required. There is no reporting. But there is also no public tender. You don't know that the government is distributing funds. Because they are not publishing that. They are distributing funds among the those that are behaving. Being media, we had a case of Republika Srpska government, so one of the entities within Bosnia and Herzegovina, that in the election year distributed 10 million KMs, which is about equivalent to 5 million euros, to media, to devoted media in Republika Srpska. No portals have received any funding, no radio stations that are not behaving received any funding. It was only dedicated to the to those news organizations that are dedicated to the political party running in Republika Srpska. That's number one. That's pretty much on the funding. So that is exactly why the funding, at least for my organization, because we are fully donor funded, that's because we are that is the reason why we are looking for the international funding, because it comes with the democratic principles that there is a transparency, there is accountability on the funds, and we can openly say that we are funded with this amount of money for this purposes, and this is what we delivered. So I mean, I just had an urge to they are not dictating the topics. But that is the. Okay. I think we have a really a misconception on what you are considering the funding and what dictate, because the government will give you exactly the topics to write, and that is wrong. But that's not journalism. That's
not.
You have to. I wanted just to comment on the bloggers. We had an affair, a scandal in Bosnia for the last elections, when the minister from one of the new parties was appointed to the minister, and he had to be checked prior to being appointed to the ministers. He completely forgot that he's employed by the political party company. So political party is establishing a company to pay the bloggers, and he was employed by that particular company. He completely forgot. And when he was actually asked about that particular case, he said that his political party that he belonged to in the last elections have never actually used that. It was something that they established but never used it. So, I mean, if they have companies that are legally registered, you can just imagine what they're using outside of the legal possibilities.
Shortly about the financing, I mean, there is also a difference between the NGOs as a model of working and media. In case of Coaditore, we are a newspaper. We refuse to register ourselves as an NGO when we were asked by European Commission, because they said you can only qualify for grants if you are an NGO. We refuse to do that because we think there are enough NGOs who could, you know, qualify for that sort of thing. So I think that it's a choice of editorial to make. And on the other hand, even if you are owned by somebody who has money, it's again a choice that you can make as an editor or as a journalist, whether you want to write something on the demand of the owner, because it's the same thing. In case of independent journalism, I think even the owner cannot ask you to write things in a certain way or about certain things. Shortly about the OSCE, because I think the comment was valid, in Kosovo, the OSCE had the mandate to create sustainable media environment. In 1999, OSCE was part of UNMIK administration. They were the pillar who had the mandate to create sustainable media environment and democratization. That was their mandate. Today we are discussing also the failure of that organization to do that. So any promise that through OSCE you can deliver something like that in media, I think it's nothing more than just a promise. I don't think it was ill meant, but generally it doesn't function like that, because OSCE is even more terrible than you when it comes to making decisions. I mean, you know who sits in that organization anyway. And I won't comment about the bloggers, but I can only add, politicians are using the social networks and everything at their disposal to disseminate lies and propaganda using the public funds. And this is the problem. It's not the problem that they do it. It's the problem that they use the money from the public money to disseminate that. The same thing as with the bloggers.
Just to add what Agron said, OSCE is kindergarten and compared with the European Union and Commission, and I think that it is really something what should be closed as soon as possible, because it is just, I can't understand the reason why that 100,000 people get salaries and spend public money for nothing. regarding their work around elections, around freedom of media, around democratic standards, they are completely unuseful. They don't have interest. They are corrupted. There are many reasons, and I really don't know what is mission of OSCE and what is sense to exist something like OSCE. But to go back to this question, I think that your question is very unfair, and I could say, because I am from media, which doesn't have any donors from West, but very unfair when you ask Svetlana and people like Svetlana who spend all lives and sacrifice all lives for mission to change society for nothing. Because right question is not why you are financed by Western donors, because you are same like this propaganda who are financed by local governments. No, right question is how and why you can't survive in market without Western donors, and that media and independent media who play that role which Peščanik play for in Serbia can't survive because local government destroy any possibility for them to earn money in some market, in normal market, in some market way, and to survive without any donor. And it is problem, and it is right question, not why you get money from donors and what is reasons and how you write when you get. No, I think that when we discuss now in Montenegro about this NATO membership and half of or majority of society support like non-NATO membership and support Russia and Putin, and I said, and put in same, not in same, they even much more criticize, especially America and this globalization and imperialism, American imperialism. But I could, of course, I am not fan of United States too, but please tell me one country where Russia implement democracy. Is there one country where Russia did something, or Russian policy, Putin or before Putin, anybody did something to implement human rights, to implement freedom of media? If we compare with US, all Western Europe was built after Second World War thanks to grants from United States. All Eastern Europe in the last 20 years, democratic values, freedom of media, human rights was built thanks to Western support and Western values. And you can't put everything in the same box and say, like you said, that donors from European Union are same like government who finance local propaganda.
I have to cut you there. I have one gentleman who wanted to ask a question, and maybe you can transfer your question to the next panel, because I was, no problem. Thank you very much, because actually, without wanting to cut off, but there are a number of issues which are already indicating the direction of our discussion for the second panel. I would like to first of all thank the panelists, because I think we got a very good insight in some of the common common features of the media situation in the region. Entschuldigung an die Übersetzer, jetzt wieder doch auf Deutsch. Die Gemeinsamkeiten, die natürlich auf der gemeinsamen Geschichte beruhen, gewissen Strukturgemeinsamkeiten, aber natürlich auch vielen Veränderungen, die die Rolle der internationalen Gemeinschaft gebracht hat, die die Entwicklung der Marktwirtschaft bzw. der demokratischen Institutionen in den Ländern gebracht hat. Da gibt es doch einige Unterschiede. Was wir auch mitnehmen können, ist anscheinend nicht besonders viel Hoffnung in eine OSZE-Vorsitz der Bundesrepublik Deutschland im Jahr 2016 für die Medienfreiheit. Und was ich als konkretes Gedankenbeitrag noch da mitnehmen möchte, ist die Idee von Crowdfunding, also die Frage, wie wir auf Digitalisierung reagieren können, wie wir vielleicht die Medien unabhängiger machen können, stärken können, die Aktivierung der Diaspora für die Medien, was Svetlana auch angesprochen hat. Das sind so ein paar Dinge, die ich aus diesem ersten Panel mitnehme. Das zweite Panel beginnt um 19 Uhr im selben Raum hier. In der Zwischenzeit können Sie sich etwas frisch machen. Und ich würde mich sehr freuen, wenn Sie dann auch noch dabei sind beim zweiten Panel, wo wir dann über die europäischen Perspektiven diskutieren. Vielen Dank.